Holy Spirit, we will never be the same.
But let me go back to the scripture we preached for 3 years. 1 Corinthians 2:9. Look at it again. Look at it again. That's why I call this exhortations of faith. But no matter how I do it, he's running away.
Hallelujah.
Come on. But you notice he says, but as it is written, I have not seen. Nor he heard, neither entered into the heart of man. Watch, the things which God hath prepared. You notice? What is it telling you again? You have to fight to get that in your spirit and don't think anything else from now until you die and leave the earth. You can't pray anything else. You can't believe anything else. You can't do anything else. But receive that God is taking you to a prepared place. You're going to die in the wilderness if you don't make this change. Last evening, even after I made the corrections with other people, and I'm all of a sudden, I'm thinking about this, and I'm thinking about that, and I said to the Lord, man, there's just so many challenges. And so many obstacles. As soon as I said that, it's like he said, it's a prepared place. I was fixed instantly. It's a prepared. Because you're wandering around in the wilderness, which is where I'm going, doesn't mean that you are not going. The road will turn straight. He said, now, when the glory comes, he made the crooked path. Let me tell you something. Whether you believe me or not, it will be to your shame when what I'm telling you comes to pass, even in your own life.
Amen.
I'm telling you, the day will come when you will stop going round and round. And the crooked path will straighten up. He said that when the glory comes, he says, every valley shall be filled. The mountain shall be brought low. The crooked path shall be made straight. The rough places shall be made smooth. And the earth shall be filled with the glory. You're going to be ashamed. Mm-hmm. So now watch. Only God knows how these things work. I'm back to my story. So they took me back to the church and did not rent the place for me. And the lady went and told the pastor that I was so prideful and arrogant. So that where she was trying to get for me, I felt that I was better than that. She was looking at my condition. She didn't know who I was.
Amen.
I said, what I'm going through is not me. Amen. This thing came to pass. You can't pigeonhole me into my moment. My destiny is greater. Hey! So they left me there. And I was there wondering, I said, Lord, what am I going to do? I know the office closes at 6. And they're about to leave. And they're going to tell me to leave the building. So where am I going? I want you, my children, to... So then she got that. So what is it going to say? I'm saying I suffered all these things. I think that's the mistake we make. We suffer, and then we have children. And then we prevent them from suffering.
Come on, Adam.
And now a little thing is a mountain.
Yeah. Amen.
We went to school. We didn't even have shoes. Hallelujah. When we went to high school, and they'll be telling us, every day you're going to bring this, you're going to bring that. They said the fence of the school is falling apart. You need to bring 20 sticks. You have to go to the woods and find the right height and cut it, and you're carrying your book bag and you're carrying all this stuff. We went through all of that to learn. Oh, do that in America. Oh, there will be so many support groups and counseling and therapy. Oh, I was abused. Yeah. There was no car. Finally, I told you that my dad gave the guy money to go buy the car and he disappeared, never came back. I didn't know that taking the wrong was in my generation. My dad never filed a lawsuit or filed even a police report or went looking for him. So eventually, you know, he got a nice bicycle, Rally. And then we'll shine it up for him and all of that. But the rest of us, we walked everywhere. Anyway, don't feel sorry for me. No. I got Eagle One now. Yeah! Yeah! Hey. That's why I said when the devil is talking to you, say, wait, look at him. If he came from back there, 17 years sick, flunking out, to being a straight-A student, and running one of the best and strongest churches on the earth, filled with glory and fire. Which armor bearer was with me? Was it not you when Austin came? Was it you that was with me? Oh, it was you. You notice, we were leaving, and the Lord told me twice or three times to ask Austin to pray. And then we went back into my office. What did Austin say? You don't remember. Look at the way he's looking at me. Austin said, of all the people, all the people that were together with us in high school, that I was the one that nobody thought will ever make it, let alone accomplish. But right now, in ministry, I am the most successful for every one of them. So when I'm telling you, when the enemy is mounting off at you, you should just say, look at that person. That's who I'm following. That's where my destiny is going. It's about time you stood up to the enemy and declare your faith.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
So I was wondering what was going to happen. And all of a sudden, a phone call came in. I was in the what they call the fellowship hall, and there was a phone on the wall just before you enter the kitchen. And that call came in, and immediately by the Holy Spirit, I knew that call was my call, my breakthrough. As soon as that phone call ended, the secretary of the church came to the fellowship hall. Instead of telling me to leave, she said, something just happened. I said, what happened? He said that a lady just called the church and said that she was praying. And God told her to call the church, to tell them that the Son of God is there, and that they needed to be careful how they handled me. And whatever it was I was telling them to do, they better do it. And they put me in the car and took me to a hotel and said, we'll continue tomorrow. That's why I spit in the face of any devil. I said, because he that is sitting on the circle of the earth. I love what Daddy Hagin said. He said, God will bypass 1 million people and go to one man that has faith. I will not allow a temporary financial condition to cause me to become who I am not. I said, I cannot win the fight over the Spellman lady that wanted me to move in with her. And she would do everything for me, file my papers. She wasn't even asking me to marry her, just move in. And I passed that to come and let you go put me in some trash. God intervened. So if you wonder where I got my swagger from, I didn't get it today. I got it in the wilderness. I got it broke, but I had it. Hallelujah. Glory, can you shout with me? Paul says that I had not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered the things God hath prepared for them that do you love him?
Amen.
Now watch. This is where we all part company. He said, but God has revealed it to us. That's what's missing. You don't have. That's why you act the way you do. You don't have your. He says, God has revealed it to us by his Spirit. That's what I'm telling you. I'm telling you. I'm describing to you the next resurrection house, where we are going, the stadium crusade. These are the things that keep me going because I have seen it. Not naturally, but by the Holy Spirit. What have you seen? Faith has sight. Nobody can keep you out of depression if you keep meditating on what you don't have.
Come on now.
Of how long it has been. Or what you still don't know yet. I don't know. I don't know what my next step is. But at least you know where you're going.
Amen.
You don't know what your next step is, but he told you already that he's taking you to a prepared place. And you need to believe him for your next step to appear. And you know that when he comes, he has the power to make it happen. And he says, I will pay you back for all the time you waited for me. I will make up for lost time.
Thank you, Lord.
What has he revealed? What has he revealed to you? What have you seen? It was amazing. I was riding around. I didn't know my covenants then. I've been riding around with my rusted car, and I treated it like it looked. I didn't wash it. That's how many of you are still operating. I'm teaching you the resurrection way. Had I known it then, I would have been keeping it, you know, spanking clean. And God would have moved me, but in his favor and grace, he still came to me and blessed me with a brand new Avalon leather. I added the sunroof. It had 12 disc changer. Man, I was rocking it then and celebrating. Do you don't know how many years Satan has been prophesying to me? Try 17 years. You know, when you keep hearing testimony, you think it's nothing. Try being sick for 6 months. Many people would have killed themselves. 17 years. Come on. Look at it so I can take you to the next one. Verse 10. but God had revealed them. You notice? Them unto us by his Spirit. So God has revealed them to us. What has he revealed to you? So if you walk around from January to December with an empty head, an empty spirit, that's why things are not changing. And I've been teaching you, stop going to God as a beggar. Forget all your list. Go and hang in his presence. Let him father you. Let him talk to you. He will show you what he has for you. I mean, you've told him the same thing. He knows what you have need of before you ask. Just relax. But God has revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things. Yeah. The deep things of God. The Holy Spirit goes in the Father and searcheth out your destiny. Amen. His plans for you. Amen. And then he reveals it to you. Amen. All right? I'm going to leave that one there. I'm going to go to the last one. Exodus. Exodus 17. And all the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journeys. It is one thing to be a wilderness. But it's another to be labeled the wilderness of Sin. You may not know it, that God named every part of their journey. He named the wilderness a certain name. Another one that comes to mind, now he called it the wilderness of temptation. But this one is the wilderness of Sin. They just kept, in this phase of their journey, they just kept sinning. They just couldn't stop. No matter how much they died, and the biggest sin was murmuring, complaining. Now, when I go back and watch old church services, I was amazed at how much I talked about murmuring and complaining, but it never stuck. Until finally the Holy Spirit hit it on the head. And brought it forth up front. Where is Victor? He's on the other side. I don't know. But I know I saw Tatiana. I haven't received any money from him. Is he trying to tell me he hasn't murmured one time since God told him that he should give $100? You better come pay up. Huh? You are supposed to look at him, yes. You have murmured at least 5 times since he told you that. And I haven't seen any offering. I figured every Sunday you'll meet me here. Glory. With the offering for the week. Hallelujah. Okay. Now watch. So this is, watch, after their journeys, according to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim. Now, this Rephidim experience happens in every destiny journey.
Yeah. Amen.
You need to listen to me carefully. Because this is the one and only battle where the battle was going back and forth. Why was the battle going back and forth? Because there was the covenant of God on both sides. It's the battle that always occurs when God is trying to take you to a prepared place. The battle that breaks out with family. And now you are commanded to make a choice between either following the destiny of God or marrying your family. That's what's killing Americans. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? Rephidim, even the meaning is a place of rest. But it was the place where Israel couldn't win outright. Why? Amalek challenged Israel. And as we will read now, when Moses would hold up his hand, Israel will win. Watch, follow it now carefully. Then when Moses' hands gets tired and then he starts falling, then Amalek will start winning. Why? Amalek is the grandson of Esau. 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 Guess who Joseph was sold to? So you can understand the heart. Now, Ishmaelites, and then they call them Amalekites. The Bible called them both. Why was the battle in Rephidim so difficult? Because the covenant of God was on both sides. It's a family trouble. That's why they're so difficult. And if you haven't encountered it, your journey hasn't started. All right. Watch. Let me read it so because I've gotten ahead of myself. Watch. He says, when they got to Rephidim and there was no water for the people to drink, how many times have they faced their water test? That shows you it's all in that nature of that issue. Even though God has done and done and done, but every time they run into a place where there's no water, they murmured exactly. Beloved, did you hear that exhortation? Rephidim, the battle that is raging between you and your family members when you make a commitment to God. Beloved, I've been called all kinds of names, cult and this and that and the other. I have members of the church that have experienced tremendous breakthroughs in their lives, blessings from God, yet their family members will not relent. They won't come to the church. They're calling us all kinds of names. And now the people have to choose between their destiny in God through this ministry or follow their family into the dungeon. And many of you are not strong enough. I've had people tell me, well, that's my family. I say, well, because they're your family, shouldn't we tell them the truth? And as you will find out, this message continues. Watch, when Moses will lift up his hands, Israel will win. When his hands get tired, Israel starts losing. What is he telling you? The covenant existed because God had a covenant with Esau. Even though he hated Esau, ooh, I heard a man preach something that was life-changing. He said, but if you look through the scriptures, Esau was blessed everywhere. Then where's the evidence of God's hatred of him? He said, God never corrected him. He said, it's only when God loves you that he chastises you. That's why God was dealing with Jacob. And Esau was left to run wild. God said, I'll make his mountains desolate and all this. That's why God gave a command to clear up Amalek. Because that time runs out until the judgment comes. And then the Saul of later on, the king of Israel, failed in the task. So when these Rephidim battles are raging in your life, who wins? The one whose worship is right. If you put God first, if you worship him, if you honor him, God will win over these family members. God will vindicate you. God, you notice even when they sold Joseph, they thought they had gotten rid of him. But they ended up bowing to him. They ended up having to get from him. They ended up having to live under Joseph's covering. And when Jacob was about to die, his wicked brothers were afraid now that Joseph will now, you know, revenge all their wickedness. Joseph said, oh, no, no, no. You meant it for evil. but God used your wickedness to enthrone me. I had to get used to it because I got tired of the pain and the rejection. And I finally said, hey, Jesus said, I'll bless you, give you a hundredfold return with persecution. So I've come to terms with it. I asked God to heal me of all the rejection. And I started enjoying the blessing and the favor of God. I stopped worrying about these naysayers. They will never end. I've been looking through the New Testament to see it in the life of Jesus. Eh? He will heal the sick, they say it's the Sabbath day. He will do this, they say it's this. No matter what, they called him a sinner. They called him a Samaritan. They told him he had a devil. The Lord Jesus himself. So who am I? Call me whatever you call me. But let me keep getting blessed of the Lord my God. Are you one of the haters? Are you one of the evil perpetrators? I'm not just talking about me personally. Who are you persecuting? Who are you judging? Who are you prophesying about? And all your venomous utterances. Are you an antichrist? It's time for you to repent. Pick up that phone, 770-994-3777. May God change your life. May God grant you grace to repent and get right with the Lord and get with the program of redemption and the expansion of the kingdom of God on the earth. American Christianity, with all these politics and the woman is king at home and all this craziness, that is not the word of God. This church is off track and deluded. That's why they all shut down during COVID and running scared. This is the time for the remnant to awake. God will do amazing things on the earth. 770-994-3777. Put your seat in the ground. We love you, beloved. God bless you. We'll see you tomorrow.